Would you like to make your own Minecraft clone but don't even know where to start? Don't worry. I also was in your position when Hobson released this Minecraft in 1 week video, and this video is here to help you. I'll briefly talk about how to get from zero to the point where you have enough programming experience to make Minecraft, and then we'll talk about technical challenges of implementing Minecraft so you know how to structure your code. As a quick side note, I use C++, but the tips here apply for any language or engine that you want to use to make your Minecraft clone. And if you are wondering why you should listen to me, well, it is because I made not one, but three Minecraft clones, and we'll talk about them later to highlight some lessons learned from them. So, I tried and tested many things, and trust me, there are important design choices that I'll talk about that you don't want to miss because they'll save you a lot of time in the future. So, stick till the end of the video. And also, don't forget to show YouTube that this video is useful by giving a like and sharing it with friends that also want to make a Minecraft clone. So, what if you are in a position where you are a beginner but still want to make Minecraft? Well, it's not a good idea to start with such a difficult project. Start with something like Terraria, which is basically a Minecraft 2D. If you don't even know how to display 2D stuff on the screen, I have many videos like this on my channel when I explain how you can start learning C++, how you can learn C++ from game development, and even how to start learning OpenGL or how to configure it. You will need OpenGL for 3D stuff if you want to do it without an engine, but leave that for later. Right now, you should just pick a framework and make a simple Terraria clone. Does it still sound too difficult? Well, try to just display one block on the screen. This seems more doable, right? Well, this is all you need. From one block, you can start adding a world, block placement, camera controls, world generation, and so on. Trust me, just start working at it step by step, because you'll learn on the way. Now, if you already know how to make a 2D game, you should start understanding 3D. You have to learn a graphics API like OpenGL. Try to make a simple 3D project, and make sure you understand all the basic concepts very well, before you move to making the Minecraft clone. After that, you have enough knowledge to start making your Minecraft clone. I'll start explaining the first steps that you have to take. All you have to do is not think too much in advance, just try to accomplish these steps one after another. Search the internet for help, or ask me directly on my Discord server. If you are scared that things won't work because you can't plan in advance all these steps, just trust me. I already make many mistakes, so I'll explain some technical things later that if you follow, you will have less problems. Let's first look at the steps. Start with a basic window and display a texture to the screen, like you did in the Terraria clone. From here, add a camera controller, like you did in the Terraria clone, but this time 3D. If you got this far, congratulations! You already got the ball rolling, so the hard part is over in my opinion. Then, you have to make a cube, and also an option to change the block type. From here, just make a chunk, only one. And if you don't know what a chunk is, it is just a segment of the world of 16x16 by world height blocks. Now it is time to optimize. If you go inside the geometry, there are a lot of faces that are drawn but can normally be seen. So let's fix that. Make some logic to draw only the faces of the cubes that don't have any adjacent geometry. Now if you go inside the geometry, you can see that nothing is drawn here. I'll refer to this process later as baking the chunk. Next, add multiple chunks. Just a fixed size for now. You also need to do the last step for the faces between chunks as well. Moreover, you might want to implement block placement as well to test if the systems are working. Finally, it would be a good time to add the chunk system and make the world infinite. After this, you basically have the beginning of your Minecraft clone, and you can continue on your own from here. Add some terrain generation, make sure the chunks generate around the player, and so on. Before we take a look at some important implementation details, let's first look at my Minecraft clones and see what we can learn from them. This is my first Minecraft clone, and it has many features including world saving. The problem with it is probably the fact that the chunk system was very poorly designed. So in my mixed clone, which was a university project, I simplified the chunk system, and this allowed me to develop it even faster. I'll explain this in the later section, but after that, I wanted to make a third clone that would add two extra features. Very big worlds and multiplayer, and here it is. I also came up with a smart way of sending data to the GPU, where I just send face types, and those are later converted to geometry inside the shader, and this also made making moving blocks not very difficult to implement. But let's now start diving into technical details that I promised. Here is the chunk class from one of my Minecraft implementations. You can see that I store all the blocks directly into the chunk, and this is because the struct will always be allocated on the heap by the chunk manager. Now chunks have this function called bake. This is the function that calculates what faces will be drawn, given the chunk geometry. Every time the player places or deletes a block in a chunk, this function has to be called. Now, I store the block faces in a vector and pass them later to the GPU, but you could just create a buffer on the GPU here directly. You can also store individual faces separately, and I did that in another implementation, and this allowed me to optimize some stuff. Now for the chunk system, I recommend doing something simple. In my first implementation, I stored chunks in a circle around the player, and only loaded chunks that were visible. And the logic to load chunks was just a mess. Just load chunks around the player in a matrix and every frame check what chunks should be loaded. Then look at the chunks loaded last frame and check what chunks should be deleted, loaded or kept. Also, you will quickly realize that generating the terrain and the bake process take time. So I recommend baking only one or a few chunks per frame. And do that starting from the chunks closest to the player. I just have a dirty flag on every chunk that is set every time I modify the chunk. And every frame, I bake a few of the closest chunks to the player that are marked as dirty. How about sending data to the GPU? Well, now you have to decide if you want the complexity of having a very big world, like Minecraft, or just a big enough world. Let me explain. A Minecraft world is not infinite, it's just extremely big, and if you want your clone to also have such big worlds, there are some extra steps that you have to do. Let's say you want the player to go from negative int limit to the positive int limit. Well, if you just store such a big number into a floating number, you won't have any precision. If you don't know how floating point numbers work, well, the bigger the number is, the less decimal places you have for it. So, if you want a very big Minecraft world, you have to store the player position as a float plus integer. And also, for the rendering stuff, you have to compute the translation in integer arithmetic. Let's say the player is at, I don't know, 2 billion or something. You can't use such a big number to correctly draw stuff to the screen. So, in my case, I just send to the GPU the block and face type and the position as an integer type. So let's say that the block position is like at 2,069 limao or something. I just subtract the player position from that to get 69, and from here I have a small enough number to continue my calculations in floating point numbers. Nice. Okay, let's talk about world generation. You'll quickly realize that it takes a lot of time. So in order to keep the frame rate consistent, you probably have to limit the chunks generated per frame. And also, try to find a fast noise library, like FastNoiseCMD. And if you don't know what noise is, it's just something that you will use when generating the map to give you some random values. Transparency is quite difficult. You have to sort the block faces from the closest to the farthest from the player. A solution would be to restore the geometry for a chunk whenever the player moves inside it, and restore the chunks when the player crosses a border. Structures are also difficult. Let's say the player bumps into a tree that is at the edge of a chunk. Well, we can't create the entire tree because half of it is on another chunk that just so happens that is never loaded. So you will get this result. The problem becomes even more apparent for big structures. The proper way of solving it would probably be to record blocks that will have to be placed in not created chunks and place them when you generate a chunk later. An easier fix that works for trees is to generate trees that are a little closer to the player, so that you are sure that it's not possible for a tree to have blocks in unexisting chunks. In order to save data, I chose to save an area of 4x4 chunks in a single file. So, I have multiple files for wall storage, but this makes the save system very easy to implement. You can even have a file for each chunk. This allows you to rely on the operating system file search system that is already optimized, so searching for a chunk just means opening a file with a specific name. Lastly, if you want to implement multiplayer, things become very difficult, so attempt this only if you have a lot of experience. But basically, you have to create a system where the player can request chunks from the server, and also request to place or break blocks. Now, you can't wait for the server to approve your block placement, so you will always be able to place that block, but if the server decides that it should not have been placed, it will undo your move. All in all, I think that we can keep our project simple and still get a very nice outcome out of it. So, if you are not yet ready to start making your Minecraft clone, click this playlist to start learning what else you are missing, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you found this video useful. See you!